Good evening, everyone.
It's my great opportunity to introduce Dr. Subramaniam, who does not need any introduction as such in our branch because he has been executive council member, the past secretary, and all. He has held so many posts in our branch itself. And presently, he is a neurosurgeon working at the Surya Hospital. And he's a very active member in our branch. Present so many interesting cases and does a great service to the mankind.
Thank you very much for inviting me to deliver the prestigious Major Parks of the Operation. I thank my Guru, the IMA Kodambakkam Executive Committee, and my father and other teachers, for we are but dwarfs standing on the shoulders of giants, helping us see much farther. The topic for today is normal pressure hydrocephalus, goes by various synonyms as have been known over the years. Occult hydrocephalus, normotensive, low pressure, idiopathic, and so on. The discovery happened much earlier to what was reported in the literature in 1960. This is a story related to me by my father, who was working under Professor Norman Dott at that time. Professor Dott, Vice President of the Royal College of Surgeons in England, the head of the Department of Neurosurgery, had a patient who was a Scottish nurse. He described the patient having been treated successfully for TB meningitis, developed difficulty in walking, and all investigations showed only progressive hydrocephalus and no other abnormality. Lumbar puncture showed persistently low pressure. This case was not published, and therefore, Hakim and Adams in 1964-65 took credit for discovery of normal pressure hydrocephalus. There are several types of normal pressure hydrocephalus, idiopathic or unknown. Many theories have been postulated, we will go to it. And there are secondary, commonly following trauma to the brain, as in subarachnoid hemorrhage, head injury, stroke, post-meningitic, and post-neoplastic. The diagnosis and general features, diagnosis is purely clinical. It's an insidious onset, slowly progressive disease, with fluctuation in severity of various groups of symptoms. There are three classical features, unsteady gait, dementia, and incontinence. Initially, there is a difficulty to walk on plain ground, on uneven ground, followed by plain ground. It's a slow, broad-based shuffling gait with short steps. Patient may feel that his feet are stuck to the ground. It is not typically like an ataxia, it is more like an apraxia. There is a tendency to lose balance and fall in turning or in negotiating stairs or while bending forward. He may get truncal apraxia, inability to sit up from a lying position. Later stages may even be unable to turn in bed, but while in bed, he will be able to move his legs normally. There is no weakness, no spasticity, no rigidity. A differential diagnosis of Parkinsonism, where the symptoms are asymmetrical and often the arm swing is absent while walking. In normal pressure hydrocephalus, normal arm swing will be present. Dementia, it may start as a short-term memory problem, being the earliest sign. There's a generalized slowing of thought, progressive severity of the memory defect, decreased in spontaneity, increased irritation, reduced reading, conversation, hobbies, apathy, lack of concern, lethargy, withdrawn as you see in many old people, fall in intellectual performance, inaccurate calculations, and decrease in attention span. But here, in differentiating, if the examiner asks the same question again, often the patient gives a correct answer. There may be an intermittent on-off effect like what you see in Parkinsonism, but here the on-off is much shorter and may happen during the examination itself. There is what is called as a Bell effect. Directly when facing the attender or the relative, the patient may not talk much, but the patient may talk normally over a telephone to some relative or friend situated far away. Other coexisting features may be perseveration, echolalia, agitation, disorientation, confusion, aggressiveness, inappropriate talk and jocularity. In a late stages, primitive reflexes may develop, and this may mimic depression and psychosis. Incontinence occurs late, usually is urinary, almost never fecal. Initially may be a progressive urgency, intermittent to constant. Sphincter tone may be normal, may be increased. Incontinence is of the frontal lobe type, and there may be immodest expulsion of flatus. Several important negative features have been described. No headache, vomiting, seizures, papilledema, dyspepsia, weakness, numbness, cerebellar signs, or focal deficit. Normal pressure heterocephalus, I repeat, is essentially a clinical diagnosis. Pathophysiology is a little confounding, and there have been learned teachers say something like this: we are forced to admit that the true pathophysiological explanation of dementia of NPH is not fully explained, and 12 years after the description of syndrome, we remain equally puzzled, but perhaps in a more detailed way. As is the same now also, more than 40, 50 years later, we still don't understand. Several theories are there. These are the most prominent theories: biomechanical, vascular disease, cerebral blood flow, interstitial fluid pressure, failure of drainage of vasoactive metabolites, CSF circulatory disorders, CSF hydrodynamics, and tissue distortion. As you can see, there are several review articles for each stream of pathophysiological postulation. Balance of disordered CSF dynamics and parenchymal factors may be attributed to decreased venous compliance, decreased cerebral blood flow, decreased absorptive capacity of the CSF, intermittent high pressure during sleep, possible vascular damage to white matter, possible changes in brain elasticity, accumulation of toxic factors, what is called as a Laplace effect, and a genetic predisposition. Distortion of the descending motor fibers to the legs and bladder in the corona radiata by the dilated ventricles has been postulated to explain the motor and bladder symptoms. However, motor evoked potentials show normal pyramidal tracts. Distortion of the fornix as it surrounds the third ventricle has also been postulated. Medical treatment is ineffective. Shunt surgery dramatically helps in some cases, is partially useful in some cases, and it's not useful in a few cases. This is the only cause of dementia that can be treated. Shunt complications are high, both due to the age of the patient on whom the shunt is done, as well as attendant comorbidities characteristic of that age. Therefore, case selection is very important. Of investigations, plain x-rays do not help. LP would show normal or low pressure. Withdrawal of about 20 cc of CSF may lead to reduction in the number or severity of symptoms. There is no post-ictal headache. CT shows enlarged ventricles, periventricular lucency, normal subarachnoid space. Serial CT scan would show progressive hydrocephalus. Radioisotope studies. A normal person injected with radioisotope, after several hours, the concentration of the radioisotope reaches the sagittal sinus and there is nothing in the ventricles. I described the Laplace effect a few minutes ago. In the Laplace effect, two balloons, for example, with water or air connected to each other, will show that the smaller balloon fills the larger balloon, as what we would normally not expect. We would expect a larger balloon to have a higher pressure, but it's not so. So this is a Laplace effect. So following the Laplace effect, the concentration of the radioisotope is seen in the ventricle after the same 48 hours. And that is sort of diagnostic of NPH. MRI is the same as CT scan. Mid-sagittal picture flow studies, CSF void is increased. But however, these are not very specific, although some sensitivity can be attributed. MRI can, by differential diagnosis, help you to exclude other diseases. There are some predictors, however, they are not fully reliable. Good outcome is seen if there is a known cause, so the shunt would have 70-80% success. Gait symptoms if they were first to appear, dementia if it was late to appear, if there was no post-LP headache, if there was a temporary remission with daily LP drainage, if the CSF infusion test showed high outflow resistance, if there was a periventricular lucency in CT or MRI, increased third ventricular width, increased flow void in MRI, and presence of B waves. B waves are seen normally when we dream. So more number of B waves, the shunt health. Poor outcome was associated with the idiopathic adult onset normal pressure hydrocephalus. If the patient showed atypical clinical syndromes, if there was associated extensive brain atrophy. What is not useful is age of onset of symptoms or age at which the shunt is done. Duration of symptoms, degree of ventricular dilatation, degree of dementia, neuropsychological testings or other tests which we normally rely on for other diagnosis. Informed consent is very important because, as I said earlier, shunt surgery may not help all the patients. Even if it did succeed, 80% of the shunts failed over 5 years, possibly because they require differences in draining pressure. Best option of surgery has been shown as ventriculoperitoneal shunt. Other shunts of ventriculoatrial, ventriculocrural, and lumboperitoneal have been helpful in some cases. Type of shunt, ideal to use a low pressure, but if a programmable shunt is available, then it helps because it eliminates the need for reoperation, either immediately after the postoperative period or few years later when the draining pressure changes. It may show an improved clinical outcome because we might be able to vary the pressure of the shunt drainage based on the symptoms of the patient and allows early mobilization of patients, especially elderly. Postoperative progress, the mental symptoms begin to improve soon. Gait takes much longer and radiological reduction in size may or may not occur. The take home message is this is a distinct entity causing progressive dementia, gait abnormalities and urinary incontinence. Diagnosis is clinical only, there is no medical treatment. Surgery gives dramatic results, there is no definite predictor, but we should make an attempt to diagnose it and treat it. Most common differentiating diagnoses are Parkinson's disease, dementia due to other reasons, and strokes of the frontal region. Thank you. Any questions?
What is the percentage?
Yeah.
In dementia.
யாருக்கு ஹெல்ப் பண்ண யாருக்கு ஹெல்ப் பண்ணாலும் தெரியாது, ட்ரை பண்ணி தான் பார்க்கணும். ஃபர்ஸ்ட் யூ ஐ சஜஸ்ட் யூ டூ அன் ஹெல்பி. இஃப் யூ திங்க் த பேஷண்ட் இம்ப்ரூவ்ஸ் தென் சென்ட் ஹிம் ஃபார் சர்ஜரி. ஹெல்பி இஃப் தே ஆர் நாட் வில்லிங் டு, தே யூ ஆர் நாட் ஏபிள் டு பெண்ட் எக்ஸெட்ரா, கிவ் மேனிடால், கிவ் ஹர் சிக்ஸ் அண்ட் சி சம் டிகிரி ஆஃப் பெனிஃபிட் மேபி.
I request Dr. Arvind, professor of gastroenterology, to hand over the certificate to Dr. Subramanian.